It's your boy Judea Blash Lamline, purified drink of water. They got it, it's out there. Shouts out to the 12 tribes. I got it, it's right there. Okay, so we was talking about the right field. So this is the beginning of the right field. And the only reason I'm calling right field, because we was talking about, because we were talking about the being black in Israel. So what we're going to do now is actually going to talk about some other stuff. And oh, and I know you heard my new, that music I like is all slowed down and or chopped and screwed type. I kind of like it like that for this whole little right field thing. So that's what that's going to be. It's may catch you light, may catch you low. Either way it go, it got a little soul in it. You know what I mean? So what I'm getting about this whole little right field thing is we're going to talk about Emancipation Proclamation, Emmett Till. We're about to talk about the, hold on, I got the list of stuff right here. We're about to talk about the black codes. We're about to talk about the Colfax. We're about to talk about 40 acres in a mule, poverty, special field order 15, objective 8, and all that stuff. We're about to get into all of that with this right field thing. So that's what that is. And like I said, you're going to stand for Israel, you got to stand for Palestine. If you're going to stand for Palestine, you got to stand for Israel, because we support the people and not the cause. And I hope today found you safer than yesterday did. And I hope tomorrow finds you safer than today and the day before. Like I said, we inside today because we got to be. So that's just what it is. So we're running these right field things. So welcome to the right field. And, hey, stop. 20-something videos, man. This right field about the wrong one. So let's get straight into that. So I said I was going to do this like this. Cue that music. I like it.
Twice. Keep it out of my sight. Yeah. Well, bitch, don't kill my vibe. Oh, bitch, don't kill my vibe. American privilege keeps blurring our vision. Inherited sickness. Oh.
Black Wall Street. By now, you've probably already heard of it and have an idea of what Black Wall Street was in America at the turn of the 19th century. HBO even made a fictional superhero series about it. If you aren't aware, here's a quick history lesson. After slaves were freed in 1863, Black Americans quickly proved to be faster learners than their slave masters thought they would be. Even after intentionally being deprived of formally educating themselves for the previous 200 years. By 1920, one place in particular was widely known as the Mecca for Black excellence. Think Atlanta, Georgia today. That place was Tulsa, Oklahoma. There were Black millionaires across the country like Mary Ellen Pleasant and Madam C.J. Walker. But Tulsa essentially became the birthplace of African-American entrepreneurship.
Black Wall Street is in many ways a misnomer, because what the business community in the Greenwood District, the Black community in Tulsa, was like, was more like, would be a Black Main Street. Since these were mostly small businesses, so there were movie theaters and dance halls and barber shops and grocery stores and restaurants and service providers like doctors and lawyers and pharmacists and dentists, hotels, all manner of businesses that you might find on an American Main Street, concentrated in a segregated Black enclave in Tulsa. Black Wall Street, the Greenwood District, was also a community of necessity. There wouldn't have been a need for a separate Black economic island in Tulsa had it not been for Jim Crow segregation. So they created their own economy in part across the Frisco tracks, separated from downtown by those tracks.
Eventually, things quickly changed. By this time, the KKK was also quickly gaining prominence, particularly in the South, and of course, were not happy. After 2 days, the Mecca of Black entrepreneurship became the center of destruction. But most, unfortunately, did not see it that way.
The community was rebuilt after that to a substantial degree, peaking in the 1940s, early to mid-1940s, with well over 200 documented Black-owned operated businesses. But then there was a second devastation. This was not a devastation effected through violence, but rather through policy.
Black people lost their fortunes and even family members and were never able to recover. Last summer, Forbes estimated that the Stratford Hotel alone, owned by O.W. Gurley, was worth about $75,000 at the time, which would be $2.5 million today. And that's just one building. Imagine how much money that was lost. This month, there will probably be plenty of media outlets re-educating us about the events that happened in Tulsa. But we gotta take things one step further, because the new Black Wall Street is here, and it's here to stay. Across the country, Black women have become the fastest growing group of entrepreneurs. In Tulsa today, the rebuilding has also begun. But the new Black Wall Street is no longer concentrated in one location. It's spread out across America.